We are so lucky. But are we intelligent? Being lucky is one thing. Because, you know, because of the luck, you really get into some nice opportunity. But are you making use of that opportunity? That is your intelligence. So there are two things to work. How the luck comes? Because of Sukruti and all the punyas, whatever you have done, past karmas. But intelligence is ours. Well, everyone, you all would have heard about the theory of evolution. It goes something like this. Actually, when I was working in Phoenix, you know, one of my colleagues was a PhD from MIT actually. He was working in my team. So, we are developing the Saturn communication software. So, he was telling, you know what, after all, you know, I came from monkeys anyway. So, I can, you know, because he made so many mistakes. I came from monkeys. I said, no, I'm not. I didn't come from monkey, maybe you. So there is a lot of controversies actually. There are so many controversies, right? This is not just one of them. Maybe it goes like this. You know people who really go to some restaurant and, you know, eating like crazy, you know? Right? Commonly think they will order. So they will say, you are eating like pigs. So this is one kind of evolution. Is that right? Do you agree with that one? So the whole creation and evolution is very complex. Even scientists are really breaking their heads. Very, very difficult. But if you look at our scripture, there is something very unique. And people used to say that this is probably what that Darwin even took it. And he expanded it. Want to click on that one? What is sloka? Different kinds of fish, different kinds of, you know, whatever you call, so many. But are they, everything is in this one earth? No, not necessarily. This is for the overall creation, distributed in all over the planets everywhere. Now, there are 2 million kinds of trees and plants. Scientists are now proving exactly the same thing. And 1,100,000 kinds of insects and reptiles. And 1 million kinds of birds. And 3 million kinds of four-legged beasts like cat, cow, and, you know, like those kind of animals. And there are 400,000 kinds of human species. There are plenty of them in this earth itself. You know, look at the Eskimos. Where do they live? They live inside the ice. Their life is different. They drink the blood of animals and, you know, like they eat raw fish, everything. They are different species, right? And then you go to the mountains and all the way, maybe in Africa where I was like, my God, there are so many tribals, cannibals. They eat you alive. If you really go there, that's it. They will cook you. They will put a big pot, put you there inside, put some masala and cook alive and eat. Scary, right? It is scary. But there are different kinds of people. So here in this world itself, there are so many kinds of people. They are different. There are 400,000 kinds of human species. How many?
400,000.
Can someone total all these? Who is very good in mathematics? Archu? You are good?
I'm not.
You are not? 8, 4, 0. Are you right there? I wanted to test you. how you are attentive to the slide. It is right there. If you add all those, it comes to
8.4 million.
4 million.
You come to brother.
Right. Huh? So many kinds of species are there.
Okay, but then you come now, to brother.
Now, the thing is, there are only 400,000 kinds of humans. But you know what? In all over the planetary system, there are 14 levels arranged in 7 planes, as per our shastras. All those who want to be born in the earth, what is that? There is a sloka, I am not going to go through the detail. Swargino api etam ichanti lokam nirayina nastada sadakam jnana vatyam ubayam tat asadakam. What that means is, this is from Uddhava Gita. The inhabitants of both hell and heaven planets pray to be born in the form of life on earth, which facilitates the cultivation of transcendental knowledge and devotional service as opposed to hellish and heavenly. Because in the hell, you don't have any time to do anything because you are always suffering. Heaven, you are enjoying. You know, you go to bush gardens. You know, where did you go last time? Maybe Disney?
I didn't ever go to.
You didn't go anywhere there at all?
No,
because, you know, it's like heaven. Heaven is like that. You know, you take rides after ride after ride, and no, you don't really want to think about Krishna there. Nobody. Did you see anyone, you know, bringing Bhagavad Gita to the Disney World? And bush gardens, you know, I am going to go to bush garden and then I am going to pay what, $100 or something, whatever, one day ticket, right? You go there and then I am going to read Bhagavad Gita. They say, my God was crazy. Right? So, the hell, you cannot do anything because you are suffering. Heaven, you are enjoying. You are enjoying. Now, that's the reason they want to come to some place where can do it, so that you can reach the gods. That's available only here, not in the hell, not in the heaven. Right? Now, how many goals are there for us? How many goals? Now, Sahasra says there are 4 goals. Dharma means, I'll explain something. What is dharma? Duty, there you go. Yes, very good. See, but I can hear the answer. Duty, that means duty. Duty means why duty? If I am born as a girl, I have one kind of duties. And if I am a boy, there is another kind of duty. For wife, there is one kind of duty. And for husband, there is another kind of duty. Once they are born in this world, what do? They start worshipping. Because they by themselves cannot do everything. They somehow realize that there is some power there. So they start worshipping. Even the dog is also worshipping. Maybe what is that maybe worshipping? Oh, today I want a very nice newborn dog born to chew. Anything like that, right? We all pray for God. Right? Now if you see all the religions, 3 things are basic. What are they? Asha, desires. I have so much desires to satisfy myself. So I pray to the God. Then Baya. Oh, people are saying hell. If I do bad things, I will go to hell. Not good. So you have fear. Then the third one, Kartavya Buddhi. Because I am born here, my father is doing this or my mother is doing that, why I will do that? Why you are doing? Don't ask me. I am just doing it. That's called Kartavya. So if you see, these are the only three things based behind any religion. Now you can mix it. Like RGB. Right? Like 3 colors. If you take the 3 colors and then mix it, you can make so many colors. And all the popular religions are some of the known colors. What we really see in every day. That's basically what it is. These are the things of how the religions come out. Then it slowly goes up. The evolution which we just talked about, right, Darwin's? Spiritually you go little higher and higher. Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha, and then everything. You go through from Sun God, then Ganesh, then Durga, then Shiva, and then Vishnu. It is actually spiritual progression. If you see that, right there, Sun God is at the air element, he takes you the Dharma. Scientists, knowingly or unknowingly, they are worshipping the Sun God. Because you know, they are studying the nature, energy. So they are invariably doing that. Then you go higher. How? Ganesh, I want to do some good things. So Ganesh will really take care of, you know, all the obstacles. So he will go for doing the good karma and all. Then
Durga.
Then you go, oh, I want to do this kind of enjoyment, I want to have this and that. So, Dharma is the, you are told the duty. Duty depending on who I am, because my duty is different, right? Suppose, because I am working in the office, unfortunately still I am doing that, but if I go to the office, I better do my duty. I work for that because I am getting money for everything, right? So similarly, right, a father, what is the duty of the father? To educate the children and then taking care of the families and support, earning money, everything is for that. Then mother, giving love and affection and also taking care of the whole house and everything like that, right? Everybody has their own duty. So this is like karma, right? You have to do that. But this is coming from the dharma. Dharma means the nature of myself, who I am, right? That's what goes. So dharma. So see here, so many people have different things they are doing depending on who they are, right? But good karma, depending on our dharma, brings punya. So if you do good thing, what will happen? Yeah, you will go to heaven. Or, right, isn't it? If you really, you know, score very good grade, what happens? Your dad gives an iPod. Isn't it? Otherwise, no iPod, not even nothing, right? So good karma brings good results, isn't it? Those also makes everyone happy, you know, you can do charities all over the place and everything you can do. Bad karma brings what? Sin. Isn't it? Suppose I really went there and then, you know, tortured someone or killed someone, what happens? I have to go to hell. I have to suffer for it. Whatever you do, you are responsible for that. So bad karma brings sin. This keeps, because you are Jivatma, no? They are all born here. Jiva, depending on their dharma, they just keep on doing good or bad and good or bad according to their dharma. This is happening, right? Isn't it? This is how the whole thing works, isn't it? We are born as whoever we are, then the duty automatically comes and we do the duty. If you do it good, then good reward. If you do bad, then bad karma comes, then it's a sin. This is going on. So bad karma takes to hell. And good karma takes to heaven. Now, but are they permanent? Right, you go to the Disney World. Alright, I'm in Disney World. I'm going to be here living in this Disney World until I die. How many of you do that? Every day you have to pay $150 or something. I think now they increase more also. So how many days you can be there in Disney World? Until your money runs out. The same way, even though you did all the good karmas, you are going to heaven, but every day counts. your bank has some money, isn't it? Depending on how much good you made, it's going on. And finally what happened one day? Broke. Then what happens? What happens then? You have to come back to this world again. You have to be born back to square one. Right? Even if one went to hell, after suffering, they have to come back. I didn't tell about that, sir. Right? Everything has a fixed time only. So depending on what you do, good or bad, you will go to heaven or hell. But then after that, what happens? When the thing runs out, come back. Like that. You know, hell is like a jail, right? You know, somebody is put in jail. They have, oh, okay, you are going to be there 5 years. After 5 years, you are free like that. Right? So you will be born again and again. So the question is, what is the end result of dharma? I am doing good things all the time. I am taking care of my parents, I am taking care of my children, I am taking care of whatever, the job and everything. I am doing fantastic. I am wonderful throughout my life. But my question is, what is the end result? That is the answer.
Is there a life sentence in hell?
Life, yeah, it's there. Yeah, but again, after that, again, dying and born again, right? So there is nothing is going to be permanent. So now what I am saying is really shocking to you. What? After doing all these good dharmas, I put so much of punyas, I opened, you know, like, you know, 15 eye hospitals. I opened so many ashrams. My God. All zero? The answer is yes. Why? I tell you why. Okay. Everyone working so hard. Right? And then what I am saying is that the result of dharma is zero. Now, this is what I am going to tell. W equal to F multiplied by T. W is work done. F is the force and D is the displacement. Suppose I have a big rock and I'm just pushing with a force, maybe even 10,000 pounds. You know, that much force I'm putting, right? I'm pushing the rock and the rock is moving. Right? Rock is moving and moving and moving. And finally, you know, suppose a child, you know, normally what happens? You know, they take a sprawling some whatever bike kind of thing. They just crawl, push, right? They apply the force. Which is they are doing the work. So move around around and finally comes to the same place. Now scientifically, what the displacement? Zero. So it doesn't matter whether the F is 10,000 or 10 million pounds, doesn't matter. The displacement is zero. So what is the work done? That's what I'm trying to say. So all the dharma, all the thing, whatever you have done, you are coming back to the same place. Right? I'm going to heaven, I'm going to hell or whatever it is, and finally what happened? I'm back to square one again. So displacement is zero. So my work done is zero. Yes?
If we come back in the same form,
yeah,
then it would be zero.
Yeah, but basically here what the scripture says is you are born as some jiva, whether you know whatever, depending on the body you take. Basically you are coming back to the same location. Same earth. You are coming, it's a jiva, doesn't matter what body you really take. But eventually, after all, depending on the you know whatever you want to do, that's what the body really carries for you. But you are coming back. So this is bizarre. Then why am I doing anything? That's what. Let us see. Krishna was instructing Arjuna, and Arjuna said, "Oh my God, I am going to kill all my relatives. No, I am not going to do that." He threw that the bow and arrow right there. Then Krishna said, "You talk like an Indrajit, but you are a fool. What is your dharma? Your dharma is, what was the dharma of Arjuna, depending on his birth? What was that? He was a warrior. So your duty is to fight. Oh, okay. Yes. Finally, that's what finally coming, right? He actually fights. But then Krishna said something very important. That shloka is very important. I am not going to go into so much detail. What did he say? The Krishna told him to, you know what? If you fight and die, you will get to heaven because you are a warrior. It's a heroine, right? You get to heaven. But if you win, you will be ruling your kingdom here. Very nicely. There, did Krishna say that, okay, you know, if you do a good karma and you will come back to Goloka Vrindavan? Did he say that? Never. You have to really understand what exactly the whole thing about. People really misinterpret a lot. He didn't, you know, he never told that. He said either you will go to heaven or you enjoy. But he never said, oh, you will come to Goloka Vrindavan. No. But at the end, he tells this. 18th chapter, 66th sloka. But he did not tell this upfront. Why he did not do that? It was not appropriate. He has to go through all those. But he says, Sarva dharman parityajya mam yekam saranam braja aham tvam sarva papebhyo moksha ishyami. All you have learned the sloka. Are you surrender to me, then I will give you moksha. What dharma? Everything you surrender to him. Don't do for you. Isn't it? So no hell, heaven, nothing. You just surrender to me. Now you remember? First three points I really put in the in your what that in the oath, right? What was the first one? Parents, then teachers means teachers, guru and all. What the third one? Now, remember now what that means here? If you do not do devotion, yeah, you are doing good karma. You are getting lot of punyas. You will get to go to heaven and everything, all the things. But if you do not do devotion, what happens? It is a perfect zero, as they say. So many zeros are there. What use is that? Because you will go to heaven and hell and come back. This is what the jivas are doing again and again. Unlimited times, this is what is happening. As soon as you bring Krishna as the sin, as the first, then what happens? All the zeros are not zeros anymore. What happens? All your karmas, whatever you do now, what? It is my God, it's a big number now. That is Krishna. So that means anything you do without devotion to Krishna, there is none, it's all zeros only. Isn't it? But if you take Krishna as the main one, and everything, whatever you do, you just doing only for him, then what happens? This is big number, because he is the one there. You understand now? Now, how do you approach Krishna? Isn't it? How do the devotion? Alright? Okay. Krishnaya Vasudevaya Kareye Paramatmane Pranatta Krishnashaya Govindaya Namo Namaha. Two more time. Krishnaya Vasudevaya Kareye Paramatmane Pranatta Krishnashaya Govindaya Namo Namaha. Again and again we offer our obeisances unto Lord Krishna, Hari, the Sanna Vasudeva. That Supreme Soul, Govinda, vanquishes the suffering of all who surrender to Him. See, Haraye, Paramatmane, He is living here as Paramatma. Every soul is inside. As Paramatma. Then Pranatta. Whatever is surrendered, Klesha, destroys. Nashaya means it is destroyed. Govindaya, Govinda, Namo Namaha means right? Yeah, I mean, that's right. I mean, we have to do devotion. But how will you know God? First to Mata. Who is Mata means? Mom. Then Pita. Pita means? Not the Pita brothers or something. Pita. Don't get about that. Okay.
Panera brothers.
Pita. Yeah. Then Pita. Then Guru. Then Deva. Deva means God. Guru means who really teaches about God. And Deva means the God. Alright. Now, what do you see in the picture? I am going to explain. This Mata, Pita, Guru, Devam, Mother, Father, Guru and God. First comes the mother, who gives birth to the child, bringing into this world with love. Isn't it? He is the one who gave everything, complete whole body. Isn't it? So first mother. And then, next comes the father, who provides support to live in this world. And also, how will you know the father? Only mother is the one who is finding out. He is your father. Alright? Then, the mother and father both take you to someone. Is the Guru. And a Guru who teaches and takes us to the God. And most of the Gurus show the way to Moksha. The best Guru takes one beyond even Moksha. Hinduism stops there. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is taking much higher. So, even beyond Moksha, what is that? Yes. What is beyond all the four goals? Dharma, Artha, Kama and Moksha. Even beyond Moksha, what is that? Krishna Prema. This is not ordinary. This is the costliest jewel one can attain. And compared to that, this moksha is you just kick with your leg. Nothing. There is a sloka also. You kick the moksha out. Because it's only a hindrance for you. Krishna Prema is the supreme. That's the topmost. But now, but to achieve that, there is some problem. This is where Hindus normally struggle also. Why? Hindus worship everybody, no? But actually the right way to do that is you respect every God because it's also form of the same Lord. But you have to have Ananya Bhakti. If you don't have the Ananya Bhakti, then this nothing will happen. What is this? Sadhu Sangha. Bhajana Kriya. Then you do want to sing for the bhajan. Bhajan. Sing for the Lord. Then anarthya, anartha nivritti. Unwanted things will slowly go away. Desiring for so many crazy things, everything will completely go away. Then nishta, you will get more attached. Then after that, what happened? Ruchi. Ruchi means the taste comes. After that, you want to chant and sing. You want to spend the whole life like that. That ruchi. Ashakti. Then you have a bonding. You have attachment to the Lord Himself. Then bhava will come. Bhava, you know, when it comes, you have the mellows. You know, you read all the pastimes of the Lord and you will feel the bhava. Then comes the prema. Alright? But it has to come only through the ananya bhakti. What is ananya bhakti? You have to have only one. Yes, well. It's what history. That's very important. Alright. Now Krishna says, those kind of devotees. Naham, yeah. Naham vasami vaikunte yoginam hridayena cha madbhaktaya pragayanti tatravastu. Oh Narada, you think that I am in Vaikuntha? No. Wherever my devotees are singing my glories, I am only there. See? He doesn't have anything. He's a pauper. For him, I am the only treasure. Besides me, there's nothing else for him. I am always staying with him only. That's the place. I'm not in Vaikuntha. Who said I'm in Vaikuntha? People go to Vaikuntha. I'm not there. I put some dummy. I put a dollar or something. So I am not there. Now, he says, dearer than my life is my devotee. Such a devotee who has a prema. Dearer than my life is my devotee. He is ever in my heart. I leave behind even the wonderful joys of Vaikuntha just to be where he is. Dearer than my life is my devotee. Like me. Dearer than my life is my devotee. Lakshmi, the better off of mine, serves my servants. My devotee's feet are holier than millions of Ganges and millions of Kashis and all holy shrine put together. Dearer than my life is my devotee. When he walks, I walk in front. When he sleeps, I wake. I don't spare the one who tries to harm my loved ones. I destroy him and even all his clans. Dearer than my life is my devotee. My devotee alone can deliver the ones whom I even shackled. I may bind someone. No, I am not going to give you moksha. But my devotee can remove that shackle whatever I have put. But not even I can release those whom he binds. He also binds me. I cannot come out of from his own lock. Once he binds me, even I can't free myself. But if he binds someone, I cannot even liberate him. Look at how a devotee has in the heart of the Lord. The Lord gives utmost importance to the devotee. Premis. Prema devotee, not everyone. Dearer than my life is my devotee. When he sits and sings, I stand and listen. When he stands and sings, I dance. Never even for a moment, I am away from him. Dearer than my life is my devotee to me. Dearer than my life is my devotee. See that now? What is in your goal? What do you want to do? You want dharma? You want artha? You want kama? You want moksha? How many of you want this? Any of this world? Who wants that Krishna prema? Yes. It is not easy. But it can be given by someone who has Krishna. If he doesn't have Krishna in the heart, how can he give? I want to light the candles, but I don't have a light. How will I myself light? So you have to really associate with those sadhus who has Krishna inside, locked up. He can't be freed up. Alright? Once, this is actually one of the Goswami. He was, you know, they normally, you know, they have, you know, like this is One is Jiva Goswami and another one is Rupa Goswami. They used to just talk and talk and talk about Krishna all the time. And what they were actually doing, all, you know, just talking. Time was going. My God. And they didn't eat anything. Still in the morning, they're talking and talking and talking. No eating. Then what? Noon after gone. No eating. Evening. No eating. My God. Then they did not feel any hungry or anything at all. Nothing. Then there was one small girl who came into their small hut. You know, they have small hut. Oh Baba, hey Baba, you haven't eaten anything. Then they looked at the girl. Oh, yeah, we haven't eaten anything. Okay, we'll eat something. We'll eat something. Okay, go and put it. Then again, what happened? They just started talking. Time was going and going. They feel so hungry. That dad again came. Hey Baba, you haven't eaten anything. You are starving. Then, yeah, we'll eat. Again, gone into the same discussion. And there was an ecstasy. They're talking and talking. They lost the time. And third time the girl came. These two are still talking about Krishna. He said, okay. He already had brought little rice. He brought some, you know, some other ingredients, even the to be light, everything. Okay, these two are very conscious. She went to the place where they used to cook. Of course, there's a small place where, you know, they're in boils only, right? So he made a nice, very nice sweet rice. Then he said, then after that he came, they were still talking and singing about Krishna and everything. Then the small girl came, then brought that. Hey Baba, I was really so sad to really see you were all, you know, starving. Please eat this. Then they could not believe this small girl did everything. Hey, what? When did you do that? Yeah, I did that because I was looking at you. You both were really like mad, you know, you were not listening at all. I decided, I brought some rice, I brought so many things, and then I cooked, and then this is what I did. Okay, you just offer to the deity and then eat. Okay, oh, this is nice. Oh, thank you. Where are you from? Yeah, I am from nearby only. I saw you were just coming here. She left. So this finally, after that, what? Almost going to the midnight kind of things. And I have to sell something to the deity now. They took the thing and then offered. Then they took little prasadam and put it in the mouth. That's it. Their ecstasy could not be expressed. They started dancing and that, and they could not believe what was happening. Then Rupa Goswami immediately thought, oh, Jiva, we made a blunder. You know who came? That is Radharani came. Look at the prasadam. How? This is not ordinary. This is not from this world at all. We are doomed. We are supposed to serve them, and now they are serving us. This is ridiculous. They were just weeping, and what again? All around them again the same thing. Bhajan and this is going on rather. So all thing was happening. Now look at, because when you have surrendered to Lord, He will take care of everything completely. He Himself comes and cooks everything. You know, look at it. Taking care of that is His duty after that. All right. So now the question here: getting the human birth is very rare. Even rare is to have a body without defects. Even rare is to be born in a good family. And even rare is to be born in a good country. Even rare is to have interest in devotion. Even rare is to have time to do sadhana. Even rare is to worship Narayan. Even rare to worship is Krishna. And even rare is to get a guru. And even rare is to get a Rasika guru. Are we intelligent enough not to waste this life? That is my summary. Right? And with that, this Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who really came as Radharani and Krishna combined, he was Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and we are just introducing the theme sloka. We are not going to go the meaning today, but we are just using that. Same tune.
प्रेम दाम दिव्य दीर्घ देह देव नंदितम प्रेम कांड पुंज निंदिका चंद्र वंदितम नाम काल नृत्य नव्य दिव्य भाव मंदिरम प्रेम दाम देवम एव नवमी गौर सुंदरम प्रेम दाम दिव्य दीर्घ देह देव नंदितम प्रेम कांड पुंज निंदिका चंद्र वंदितम कामगान नृत्य नव्य दिव्य भाव मंदिरम प्रेम दाम देवम एव नवमि गौर सुंदरम।
कृपा करो